honor guard. So I went to his headquarters in Frankfurt, Germany, and I was his part of his honor guard for a year. And while I was there, one of the reasons I did is because I wanted to see for myself whether the people of Germany knew what was going on. So I had one family that befriended me, and so Anita was the girl. She lived with her mother and her grandmother. All three women had lost their husbands in the war, and Anita had lost her child to typhoid. And a cigarette to them meant many more, was more important than the marks, the German marks. So I would give them cigarettes, and the mother would drive her bicycle up in the farmyard and pick up dairy products, bring them back home, and they would invite me over for dinner. And I remember one, the New Year's Eve, they do there on New Year's Eve just like they do here on Halloween. You go and ring doorbells, and they come to get through the door, hand you a shot of schnapps, and then you dance some waltzes. And then I had one more girlfriend over there named Brunhilde. And Brunhilde, I had a dog, Queenie, and I inherited this dog. The Germans had trained the dog to smell out Frenchmen. And so we had to untrain and a Queenie to smell out Germans, because this was the Battle of the Bulge, and a lot of the German army had taken our prisoners and used their uniforms to invade our lines. So when I left, I left my Queenie to Brunhilde, and that was in Frankfurt, Germany, and that's where Eisenhower's headquarters was, SHAF, Supreme Headquarters, Allied Expeditionary Forces, and I guarded his airplane on the tarmac, and I also ran an enlisted men's club in downtown Frankfurt, and I had a couple of trucks, and in the morning I would go to Wiesbaden and pick up supplies, liquor and food, bring it back, and then in the afternoon I'd take my personnel carrier and pick up 8 Fräuleins, bring them back to my nightclub, and they waited the tables. And so that's just something to add on to that.
Other questions? This is a rare opportunity to talk about World War II. Yes?
Did you speak to your experiences with the concentration camps? I know that's an extremely powerful and obviously impactful experience.
Could you speak to your
I didn't hear the question.
Could you speak to your experience with concentration camps?
Well, I was one with a Patton's army that liberated Buchenwald, which was the largest concentration camp in Germany. Auschwitz was the largest concentration camp in Poland. And those were the two largest camps. As soon as we liberated Buchenwald, Eisenhower and Patton marched everybody from the town through that place, and they started sending all of their high school classes through to make sure that they knew what went on. And in Auschwitz, I visited there with my wife, and the first, you go under a sign that said, work means freedom. And the first building is a building completely with suitcases in, because these people had been told that they're going on a vacation. The second one was filled with shoes. The third one was filled with human hair. And back at Buchenwald now, it was run by the witch with a B of Buchenwald. And she rode her pony around the camp. If you weren't working fast enough or hard enough, she used this crop, her crop to urge you on. And her favorite thing is to find people with tattoos that appeal to her and use those tattoos to make lampshades and book covers. So.
In Dachau, they had a fake shower room for the gassing of them, but they couldn't gas them fast enough at the end. They would try. So they had sumps outside with the wooden slats, I don't know what you call them, grates, wooden grate, where they could put people out there six, seven at a time and shoot them through the head and let them drain. And then they couldn't burn them fast enough, so they were shipping them out by railroad car when the guys from 3rd and 7th Army got there. And as I say, I was there just a few days after the war. I didn't see it on the day that it was liberated, but I saw what they did. And to see a town that looked so much similar to Ann Arbor, the place in Galesburg, where I grew up, and to think that that could happen at the edge of that town was just almost more than a young guy could absorb.
As soon as the German guards realized that their time was limited, they all ran. And then, so we could take all of the prisoners to the nearest hospital and make sure that they're okay. But I myself had one of my companies completely surrounded during the Battle of the Bulge and made to march miles and miles and miles. Half of them didn't make it. The rest of them died before they could fix them, take them to the hospital.
So this impacts your perception of humanity, of the enemy. Mm-hmm. Pretty soon you want to kill them all. And yet, you know, Ann Arbor was originally a German town, primarily a German town. So when hostilities stopped and you went into the town, or the German town, they kind of looked like us, right?
Their language is different otherwise.
Well, I had an interesting experience right at the end of the war, closing days. My mission in that thing was that right behind the line troops and going in it, and we were to take the railroad station and check everything for mines, booby traps, and so on, and take over whoever was there, if somebody was there. The bigger city was destroyed, but I went into this little town right by the Austrian border. And the station master, he was an old man, but he was probably 55 years old, and he was scared to death. They'd been told that we would kill them and rape the women and all that stuff, and he was scared to death. And my German at that time was Dankeschön, thank you, you're welcome, please, and Heißwasser, hot water, and you don't get very far with those. And so I'm trying to tell this guy that we're not going to kill him and so on. And in walked a young German man about my age, turned out we were 2 months apart, and he, in Lederhosen. And he said, he's my father and I speak English. And I said, well, tell your father nobody's going to be hurt. We're here to take over the place, and he no longer takes orders from whoever he takes orders from. He takes orders from myself and my men. But we're not here to hurt anybody. We're here to get a job done. He did. And then the light lit in my foggy brain, and I thought, what's this guy doing here who's apparently in decent health and my age, and they were so desperate for people, they were taking 16-year-olds in. So I just said to him, are you a member of the Wehrmacht, German Army? He said, yes. And I said, well, you're a prisoner of war. He looked me in the eye, I said, yes. I said, are you armed? Yes. And I said, where's your weapon? He reached in a stove and got a P-38, which had one in the chest. I didn't have the gun out of my holster for some reason. And my driver, Hendrickson, was standing there. But he just handed me the gun. And I said, well, you need your name, rank, and serial number, which was what we're supposed to do. Now, they'll tell you people that are that are students here, there are students, I guess, that there's a hell of a lot of stuff that happens that you're not going to be trained for. It's common sense stuff. And so he gave me his name, rank, and serial number, and I quizzed him about why he was here. He said, well, I was in the infantry on the Russian front, was captured, and I escaped, and just got back to his house 2 days before, or something like that. And his name was Carl Steinbeifer. And I said, not 20, but 20, barely 23 years old. And I said, Steinbeifer, I need an interpreter. And so I said, I can take you to prison camp. But I said, if you would consent, I would never heard of doing this, but I'll keep you as my interpreter. I have a prisoner of war uniform for you. I can't guard you all the time. I have to pick you up in the morning and take you back at night, but you're my prisoner. And he said, and you can be interpret for me, and you'll be with me in a prisoner of war uniform all day. And he said, I'll do it. And I said, your choice, you go to prison camp. We had a prison camp of 50,000 prisoners in it, about 30, 40 miles away. And he said, I'll do it. And I took him and kept him. I finally got him discharged out. He was a good guy. We got to know each other real well. I saw him 40 years later. That's another story. In Germany, when we were 63 years old, but I talked to him about the concentration camp thing, and he said, you always call him Lieutenant, he said, Lieutenant, I had heard things, but he said, I didn't believe them. Mm-hmm. He said, I couldn't believe the things that I heard.
Yeah.
And after I saw Dachau that day, I had him, of course, before I ended Dachau, I came back from that thing, and I said, you can have no idea what your people have done. And I told it to him, and he believed me. And I said, they're going to open that sometime soon for you people, but I want you to be first in line. But when I saw him 40 years later, almost to the day, May of 1985, he said to me, he still called me Lieutenant. You know, we got together and had dinner together. Went shopping together, had our wives with us. I was over there on business. And he said, Lieutenant, he said, I was not the first in line, but I was in the first 20 minutes when I went to Dachau. And so there was the urge to kill and all that, but there was also compassion, and I never regretted what I did. I'll just tell you one more quick thing. I took him to prison. I told him I had to take him to prison camp in July, about 2 months after the war ended. I said, I got to take you to prison camp. Oh, no. Yeah, tomorrow morning early. And I took him, he wanted to go, they were sending him back to France. And I came in there, and he had all these prisoners, that big, big Quonset building, and his major was sitting there, and I said, they got this prisoner, and he needs to be taken in and processed. He said, where has he been? And I said, well, I need an interpreter, and I got him just before the end of the war, and I kept him as an interpreter. He said, I never heard of any such thing. I said, I haven't either, but I did it. It's easier to ask forgiveness than it is to ask permission. And so he said, okay. And Carl, of course, was scared to death. He said, I need his papers. And I told him to bring all his papers, and he had papers out and gave them to the guy. And I said to the major, I said, I'd like to have him out as soon as possible because he's really vital to me as an interpreter. And he said, well, how quick do you want him? And I looked at my watch, and I said, well, I'd like to have him by noon. True story. He took it. He had a pen in his hand, and he threw it down on the table. He said, Lieutenant, we've been in a goddamn war. And I said, I know, Major, I've been in it. And I said, you guys are having a heck of a time up here with food and clothing and blankets and all that stuff. This is the guy that knows his father's a railroad man. He knows something about the railroad. You have an interest in him being out or something similar to that. And he walked out at 1 o'clock, a free man. And I said, Carl, you don't even have to ride back. Lieutenant, I'll stick with you always. So he was with me all the way till I got promoted in October and left. And then I saw him, of course, that 40 years later. But as Lori said, they're your enemy and you want to kill them. But when that thing happened, here I was talking to a guy in my own language who looked just like me. It turned out we were too much for the same age. And I'd do the same thing over again today. I think I did the right thing.
Well, I could read to you what Dad said in his mission log.
Yeah,
that might
yes.
be a bit relevant. Just about...
I want to interrupt real quick. There's a major veterans event at Hill Auditorium. It starts at 7 p.m. on Wednesday. We have some
flyers up there, too.
Yeah, it's a two-hour show, and it's free. So you're all invited to that.
Yes, please.
In addition to the other panels this week. All right, I'm sorry. We'll see.
It's just brief. This is the introduction to his mission log. He says, if a friend finds this book, please destroy immediately. If foe, may the knowledge contained herein serve to remind him of the cost and penalty of adhering to barbaric doctrines for national grandeur. Ce n'est pas notre nature. It's not our nature.
Beautiful. Any other questions? We're running sort of towards the end as people are going properly in terms of the time. Any other questions?
I just have a quick question. Do any of you gentlemen or you as well come to schools, or are those kids too squirrely to talk?
What level?
I'm thinking eighth grade.
What was the question?
Would you go and talk to middle school students? Does that seem something that would be appropriate for the stories?
I would be willing to. I'll be gone for the winter to Florida, but I would be willing to if I'm still alive.
I will go to any school that you've got and talk, because I'm really interested in making sure they know what we went through.
Mm-hmm. Me too.
Well, I live in East Lansing, and I'm not driving these days. So.
And I urge everybody here, if they haven't seen the Holocaust Museum in Farmington Hills, go take a look. That's where I met Michael Weiss. And it's they have a boxcar in the museum, and they have movies and everything. It's really worthwhile.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Terrific session.
Did you have a couple gifts for the gentleman? Real quick. Oops. Stretch. Coffee mug.
And oh, boy, thank you very much.
We gave one to Bill during the Korea War vet panel. We have a coffee mug for you.
Look what's in it, vodka.
Those drink.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Welcome.
Thank you. I didn't tell anybody, but I went through. I got a bachelor's and master's degree on the GI Bill here in Michigan. That is the best thing that ever happened to me.
What field?
I graduated with a language professor, a teacher, because I had 6 years of Latin, 4 years of Greek, and 2 years of French, and I learned German overseas. And when I went to my counselor, he said, "You're in the wrong field. Start all over again." So I went to, they gave me a couple of days of tests, and they said, your future is going to be either a farmer or an accountant. I picked the accountant. It's a good pick for me.
Let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your interest.
Yes, thank you very much.
We have flyers up front. This is the first day of a week-long series of panels and discussions and events for Veterans Week. So please take a flyer on your way out and come join us for some more of our stuff this week.
Very interesting.
Okay, thank you, Phil. Thank you. Vietnam tomorrow at 10.
Yes.
Vietnam tomorrow at 10.
Okay. Well, that's PBS?
No, that's here.
I'm going to do Vietnam.
Oh,
yeah. Let's get some. I got some papers. Well,
yes. Phil. Where's this? Our speakers would like to attend the appreciation lunch, and they are invited, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just come.
Nothing to write.
Just come.
Just come.
Absolutely. Just come. Before the anybody with you?
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. No, I don't know.
Oh, yeah, just a...
He's going to give me his number on that.